welcome everyone to the COC Convention of EMA. A good start of the year.
Thank you. So, I guess I'll get going.
Well,
it's not
12:30.
It's alright, the panel's here.
Good
yeah. Yeah, when you feel comfortable to start.
Okay, good. So indeed, thank you for the introduction, Alex. I'm going to be presenting today the plan for my thesis, the plan for my next 2 years of work, which, as I'll articulate today, is going to center on exploration of latent profiles of aspirations or life goals, and then subsequently an assessment of the extent to which membership to those profiles relates to various indices of optimal functioning. So before I dive into the theory today, I wanted to give everyone in the room the opportunity to get some first-hand exposure to some of the items that are designed to tap these aspiration variables. Now, it's certainly possible that a number of people in the room have already used this measure and are familiar with it. Of course, its co-developer is in the room, so he's feasibly pretty familiar with it. But I wanted to show you some of the items so that you can answer them, and for anyone who's not familiar with it, get a better kind of connection or understanding with the ways in which we're trying to tap these variables. So using this scale right here, 1 being entirely disagree, 7 being entirely agree, and in answer to the question, it's important to, you can just answer these to yourself, it's important to make the world a better place, to be rich, as in wealthy, not to be rich. To have good friends I can count on, to successfully hide the signs of aging, to grow and learn new things, to be admired by many people, and to be physically healthy. And so each of these items is one of 5 that are designed to tap 7 specific aspirations as measured on the Aspiration Index, which was developed by Tim Kasser and, of course, Rich, across 3 studies starting in 1993. Now, of course, given its creators, the Aspiration Index is situated within self-determination theory, which holds that a relative emphasis on certain types of life goals will reflect one's value orientation, of which there are 2, an intrinsic value orientation or an extrinsic value orientation. And consistent with SDT's organistic dialectical perspective, intrinsic values are thought to reflect humans' innate growth tendencies, or tendencies towards growth and integration. And therefore, the pursuit of these types of intrinsic aspirations is thought to inherently satisfy our psychological needs for autonomy and confidence and relatedness, and therefore promote well-being. While in contrast, an extrinsic value orientation or extrinsic aspirations are thought to reflect more coerced and controlled processes that only, at best, indirectly satisfy our basic psychological needs. Now, in the first studies in 1993 and 1996, the aspiration for wealth was used to encapsulate extrinsic aspirations, and that was compared to the intrinsic aspirations for personal growth, relationships with others, and giving to the community. And factor analyses in those 2 studies found that they were indeed distinct constructs, intrinsic and extrinsic aspirations. In a number of subsequent analyses, these types of aspirations have been kind of fleshed out, as in reflected by other types of aspirations as well. And now intrinsic aspirations are thought to be reflected by personal growth. So this is a want to grow and develop, to feel autonomy, feel a sense of self-authorship in your life. Relationships, so this is close, deep, intimate relationships with others. Community giving, so working to make the world a better place. And physical health, so the pursuit of a healthy lifestyle. And now, extrinsic aspirations are thought to be represented by the pursuit of wealth, but also the pursuit of fame, so the admiration of distal others, and image, which is the pursuit of an aesthetic appeal, physical aesthetic appeal. And in addition to have regularly and consistently been identified or distinguished from one another as distinct constructs, these reliably over multiple decades now, these 2 relative aspiration types, or relative emphasis on either of these aspirations, also differentially relates to a variety of optimal functioning indices. So Speaking really broadly, an emphasis on intrinsic aspirations enhances things like meaning in life, life fulfillment, vitality, self-actualization, mindfulness, empathy, and the list goes on. Whereas a relative extrinsic emphasis, so if your emphasis is on extrinsic aspirations more than it is on intrinsic aspirations, not only negatively predicts those same variables, also predicts negative variables such as distress and anxiety and depression. And the differentiation of the two and also their differential relationships to well-being have been replicated across multiple decades and in a number of different countries. So obviously the initial samples were from America, but it's since been replicated in a variety of countries: Russia, Germany, Iran, Turkey, Hungary, Australia, and so on. So it's a robust pattern of findings. Though despite this cross-cultural robustness, there are three primary critiques that have been presented with regards to this conceptualization of aspirations. And the first I've termed the match perspective. It has a couple of different names, but it's the name that I've assigned here will make sense as I describe it. So this was proposed by Sargib and Schwartz and borrows from Schwartz's theory of universal values, in which Schwartz says that no one value will be advantageous or detrimental. What is important is the extent to which the value held is matched in the environment. And they found some evidence to support the match perspective with regards to aspirations by separating university students of different university faculties. They found that future students and future doctors' well-being was enhanced by only an intrinsic or relative intrinsic orientation, whereas for future entrepreneurs, both an intrinsic and extrinsic aspiration orientation promoted well-being. And they argued this was a function of perhaps a feasibly more extrinsic environment, that future entrepreneurs were in a more extrinsic environment. There's been studies, follow-up studies, some in support of this and some not in support of the match perspective, though conceptually and from my perspective, I think it's kind of fraught because it assumes that environments have values independent of the people in them, whereas feasibly values in any given environment are a function of both the people in them and the values of the field. It's a kind of reciprocal relationship. Also, it supposes, if the match perspective is true, it supposes that we primarily function within intrinsic environments because intrinsic aspirations are reliably found to be more beneficial, which particularly in a Western market economy wherein we place strong emphasis on the acquisition of things and the promotion of wealth, it would seem that a number of our environments are extrinsic. And if the match perspective is true, it should mean that extrinsic aspirations are more often beneficial, which they're not found to be. In the second critique, I termed the why explanation. And this, from Carver and Baird, supposes that focusing on the what of aspirations, on the content, the fame, the relationships, etc., washes the construct of the importance of motive or why you're pursuing a particular goal. And in this particular study, they found that when they entered autonomous and controlled motivation orientation into a regression, intrinsic and extrinsic aspirations failed to independently predict well-being outcomes. Subsequent studies have once again failed, supported and failed to, and falsify this particular pattern of findings, particularly when it comes to student learning. Expectancy value theory or expectancy valence theory is the third critique that has been proposed. And this particular critique hinges on the regular finding that, speaking broadly, intrinsic aspirations are rated as more important as extrinsic aspirations. So the mean for intrinsic aspirations is usually higher than the mean for extrinsic aspirations. So expectancy value theory holds that the reason intrinsic aspirations are more beneficial is because more value is placed upon them, not necessarily because they're qualitatively distinct from extrinsic aspirations. And that one has been quite well tackled within student learning, within the context of student learning, in studies where students were presented with a learning outcome with an intrinsic goal framing, a learning task with an extrinsic goal framing, and a third group who were presented with a learning task that had both an intrinsic and extrinsic goal framing. And if expectancy value theory is true, that latter group ought to perform best because they have the value assigned to the intrinsic component and the value assigned to to their extrinsic component. So that should have the most value and therefore the best success, which was not found to be the case. It underperformed the intrinsic only condition and was not different from the extrinsic goal framing condition. So what I've attempted to do in, I guess, introducing each of these three critiques is briefly discuss the ways in which they've been tackled. And it is certainly the case that they've each been tackled in a number of individual studies, and particularly, as I said a couple of times, each of these has been addressed with regards to student learning quite thoroughly, results favouring the SDT interpretation of aspirations rather than any of these three findings. But no synthesis or systematic review exists unifying these three and the counter results with specific regard to optimal functioning. And so that gap will, addressing that gap will be an important part of the first study in this thesis. Everything I've presented so far, both the results in favour of and not in favour of the SDT interpretation of aspirations, has been primarily based upon variable-centred analyses, which of course makes sense because variable-centred analyses have been central to analysis for a century plus. But there are a couple of less emphasised, consistent patterns that are observed in the aspirations literature that indicate that purely focusing on variable-centred results may hide an important and meaningful level of detail with regards to outcomes. And a way that this can be tackled is via person-centred approaches. So I say that it's the case that, so the patterns that exist in the data that are less emphasised but perhaps important in this regard are that all of the aspirations, all seven of them in both domains, are most often positively correlated. So wealth positively correlates with relationships, for example, image positively correlates with physical health, which indicates that they may not necessarily be universally divergent, and in some people may actually be convergent. So some people may equally aspire to all seven aspirations above average, or aspire to all aspirations below average, or have a high emphasis on wealth and an equally high emphasis on community giving, for example. And we could test those things using variable-centered methodologies, but it would require something like an interaction in the order of a seven-way interaction, the interpretation of which would be complicated at best. Fortunately, however, there are person-centered approaches that we can depend on to provide a more tenable alternative to testing questions such as this. And a person-centered approach where variable-centered approaches depend on, as we know, the assumption of homogeneity. A person-centered approach doesn't depend on that same assumption and takes into account each individual participant's individual response pattern with the aim to extract subgroups for whom that pattern of responding is the same. And this strategy has been applied with the in analysing the aspiration index in just one study so far. And their analysis found support for a four-cluster solution. So this analysis used k-means cluster analysis to derive clusters based on just the higher order intrinsic and extrinsic aspirations. And their results supported a four-cluster solution. The first is our kind of intrinsic archetype. This is sort of, I guess, what we're thinking of when we're thinking intrinsic aspiration. So someone who is high on intrinsic aspiring and low on extrinsic aspiring. So I've included the Dalai Lama as a nice indication of this particular cluster. And then we have our extrinsic archetype. I couldn't think of a... but this is Kim Kardashian, for any of you fortunate enough to not know who that is. And this group are low on intrinsic aspirations and high on extrinsic aspirations. I couldn't think of a better personification of extrinsic aspiring than the Kardashians. But their profile also supported two additional clusters, one that is high in both domains, high intrinsic, high extrinsic. It was tricky to think of someone for this, so I included Bill Gates here, obviously high wealth aspirations, but also a high aspiration to keep that wealth away. And also a low intrinsic, low extrinsic. I didn't want to assign this to an actual person, so I picked Homer Simpson in this regard. And so I guess the derivation of these four clusters is perhaps not really substantively important because it makes logical sense, right? There's no other configuration of two variables that you can have apart from low on both, apart from the four that we have here. What's more important though is that these authors were able, so Riabeth and Pradhara et al., were able to then compare these four profiles on measures of well-being and basic psychological need satisfaction. So who do we think was the most, had the most well-being or the most...
Which well-being measure?
Oh, they used vitality and self-actualization as their well-being metric. And then the basic psychological needs satisfaction scale. So who do we think would have had the most well-being and the most basic psychological need satisfaction of the four?
Homer Simpson.
Thanks. You were told to behave. So realistically, who do we think had the most well-being and basic psychological need satisfaction? You can say the person if you can't remember the name.
Okay.
Interesting. Yeah. So for the most part, this would support the existing theoretical distinction that an emphasis on high intrinsic aspirations is good for you. But as Mike has rightly pointed out, equally highly was the high intrinsic and high extrinsic group. So these two groups were no different. So this is perhaps a bit slightly counter to the existing literature because it supposes that having high aspirations in both domains is as important as having, or as beneficial as having high intrinsic relative to extrinsic aspirations. And just for your reference, it was Homer Simpson was the least in both domains. That's not a particularly shocking finding, given that broader goal theory would suggest that having goals in general is better than not having goals. So this is why these guys underperformed those in the high extrinsic group. But questions remain, because obviously that finding that a relative intrinsic orientation is as beneficial to well-being or optimal functioning as a high emphasis on both aspirational domains is counter to what we currently understand about aspirations more broadly. So it's difficult to kind of elucidate the mechanism that might have informed that without considering the broader spectrum of the seven aspirations. And so that is the central aim of the four quantitative studies of this thesis. So the first study aims to unify the literature I presented earlier, so provide a synthesis of that which exists in favour of and not in favour of the intrinsic-extrinsic differential relationship to well-being and optimal functioning, which doesn't exist at the moment. So following the Cochrane Collection Protocol, I'll of course assemble an expert panel. We'll decide upon the inclusion criteria, given that optimal functioning is a relatively broad term, so decide on what those terms are. Provide a pilot review and then do the actual review. Of course, aiming to reduce database bias and publication bias and language bias by searching a multitude of databases in all languages and of reaching out to the community as well to see if there are any unpublished results that we ought to also include. Study 2 is the first of four quantitative studies that will consecutively or cumulatively help build a person-centered framework through which we can examine aspirations. So the first of these studies aims to build upon the cluster analysis that I introduced earlier in two main ways. The first is to include the full spectrum of the aspiration index, so all seven aspirations, instead of just the two higher order categories as the first step. And two is to account for the orientation effects, which weren't accounted for in the cluster analysis. Now, what I mean when I say that is, while it's true that people differ in the extent to which they endorse particular individual aspirations, people also differ in the extent to which they aspire in general. And this has been taken care of in the original 1996 Aspiration Index paper, but in a number of studies since, by entering total aspirations, so the mean across all seven aspirations in step one of a regression, and then entering the intrinsic and extrinsic aspirations in step two, such that we can consider the relative emphasis. So I'm going to use that methodology in a latent profile analysis. So I've already mentioned one person-centered approach that you could use, K-means cluster analysis. Latent profile analysis is widely recommended on the basis of its relatively robust statistical criteria for classifying or supporting subpopulations. So I'll be using latent profile analysis in all four of the quantitative studies. And in this one, I'll be using those residualized subscale scores, so subscale scores controlling for total aspirations as indicators in the latent profile analysis. So this study will aim to address two major questions. The first is, will a latent profile analysis of a wide spectrum of aspirations yield unique configurations of aspirations? And I'm expecting in all four of these studies that yes, we are going to find distinct configurations of aspiring within the broader samples. And to save me repeating this phrase again and again, you can take it as a working assumption that I expect some of the unexplained heterogeneity to be explained by this unobserved source. So in our analyses to date, we attempt to control for potential sources of heterogeneity explicitly by gender, by age, by ethnicity, and so on and so forth. But it's also possible that that heterogeneity can be explained by the existence of subgroups that we didn't measure for. So I expect that to be the case, and across the board, expect to consistently find distinct configurations in the four samples that I'll be using in these studies. So yes, expecting to find distinct configurations, certainly on the basis of the cluster analysis, expecting to find one that is more intrinsic than extrinsic, and one that's more extrinsic than intrinsic, and beyond that, it's difficult to know what the profiles will look like when we're including the full spectrum of the 7 aspirations. And once I've derived the configurations, I'll test the extent to which gender and age predict membership into those profiles. It's a fairly reliable finding within this literature that females tend to endorse intrinsic aspirations more than males do, and that males tend to endorse extrinsic aspirations, in particular wealth, more than females do. So I'll expect the likelihood of belonging to a more intrinsic profile to be greater for women and less so for men, and the same for extrinsic profiles. They're more likely comprised by males. Though age is, I'll test for it, but age is not expected to be a significant predictor. The differential relationship between intrinsic and extrinsic aspirations is robust across age groups. I'll be testing these questions in an archival sample of 753 Hungarian university students. So I've been lucky enough to obtain a number of useful data sets that I'll be using throughout these studies, and this is the first of them. And in this study, they use the previously validated Hungarian version of the 35-item aspiration index. Now, while study one is an important first step in developing a person-centered framework for the analysis or understanding of aspirations, I'm expecting it to be limited in a couple of key ways. Firstly, even when you control for total aspirations, the specific aspirations within each of the higher order domains are strongly positively correlated. So wealth and image and fame are strongly positively correlated, which means that which I expect to be demonstrated in the latent profile analysis from study two, in that they don't differ from one another. I put differently, I expect those profiles to be a representation of level, value orientation, more so than the specific shape of the individual aspirations. So it will look as if wealth, fame, and image, for example, are relatively the same in the shape of the profile, and the same for the intrinsic ones, because we won't have been able to separate that which is shared across the three aspirations from that which can be attributed to a specific aspiration itself. So I'll be taking care of this in study three by, instead of using the residualized subscale scores as the indicators in the profile analysis, and instead using factor scores from a two-factor, bifactor exploratory structural equation model. Building on the theory that already exists, this model is going to have two global factors, intrinsic and extrinsic, and then 7 specific factors, one for each of the 7 goal types. And what takes place here is that the two global factors, the intrinsic and the extrinsic global factor, will take up that which is shared across related subscales. So the extrinsic global factor will represent variance shared among the three extrinsic aspirations, leaving behind variance attributable only to the specific aspiration. So what it will mean is, in all likelihood, those level effects, intrinsic and extrinsic, will likely be similar to what we see in the broad pattern in study two, but we'll be able, so that will be mapped in the intrinsic and extrinsic global factors, and then we'll be able to zoom in on the shape of the specific aspirations. So again, two questions here. Will a latent profile analysis using factor scores from a BESM yield configurations of specific aspirations? Once again, I think that it will, based on aforementioned rationale. And what are the demographic predictors? So once again, I expect that gender will predict membership to intrinsic profiles for females and extrinsic profiles for males, and age to not be a significant predictor. Once again, I've got an archival sample of 3,370 people from Hungarian universities upon which I'll conduct this analysis. Once again, using the 35-item Hungarian Aspiration Index. So in study four, of course, it'll be an important first step in study four will be to attempt to replicate the profiles derived in study three. This is important because we need to assess the extent to which they're a function of random error or statistical artifact or only pertinent to the sample from which they were derived. So that's an important first step in study four. We need to attempt to replicate the profiles derived in study three in an independent sample, which is what will take place here. But in addition, even if we manage to replicate the profiles, it's important that we find that they're meaningful, that it's important. And in doing this, I'll be comparing profiles derived on a variety of theoretically relevant covariates. And then finally, because, as I'm sure you're picking up by now, this complex analytical framework is much less parsimonious than a traditional variable-centered approach. So it's important in a last step to demonstrate that this approach adds value to that which can be obtained from a traditional variable-centered approach. So in order to test that, I'll be comparing the three profiles once again on those same theoretically relevant covariates, whilst controlling for the two global and seven specific factors used to derive the profiles. So it will obliterate variance, but hopefully leave some variance behind that can be attributed only to class membership. So what that will mean is profile membership is a significant determinant of the outcome variable independent of the aspirations themselves, thus demonstrating the added value of the complementary value of this approach to traditional variable-centered methods. So three questions here. Will the profiles replicate? Will profile membership be meaningfully linked to gender and age again? And will it predict optimal functioning outcomes? So once again, gender is expected to predict, age is not, and we'll expect profiles with a more intrinsic focus, so higher intrinsic level effects and an emphasis on intrinsic shape, so a focus on specific aspirations that are intrinsic, will relate to various measures of optimal functioning. And in addition, we'll expect that relationship to continue even when controlling for the two global and seven specific factors. Otherwise, we can't say that profile membership or the existence of latent subsamples accounts for some of that unexplained heterogeneity. If it can't continue to explain some whilst controlling for the two global and seven specific factors, then it's not particularly useful. So we'll be doing this in a sample from the Australian Character Study. So this is a 1,632 person sample from the Australian Character Study. And in this sample, we'll be using the original Australian version of the Aspiration Index and focusing on these variables as outcomes. So we're using KEYS well-being measure. So that measures social, emotional, and psychological well-being, all of which are expected to be higher for a profile that has a more intrinsic orientation or a focus on more intrinsic goals. GHQ, so this measures distress symptomology, so more extrinsic profiles will be expected to have more distress than more intrinsic profiles. The Engaged Living Scale measures the extent to which you feel you are living a life congruent with your values, and also the extent to which you're satisfied with that life. So once again, this is a measure of optimal functioning and we'll expect more intrinsic profiles to have more engaged living. Mindfulness has been related to a relative intrinsic orientation using variable-centered methods, so we'll expect those who are more intrinsic to be more mindful. And in addition, intrinsic aspirations are thought quite broadly to reflect more of an other orientation than a self-orientation. So extrinsic aspirations are more self-oriented, satisfying self, than they're working for others. And in that regard, we'll expect more other-oriented profiles, more intrinsic profiles, to report higher levels of other-oriented variables. And in this case, we're using non-attachment and cognitive and affective empathy. And then study five really serves to unify the preceding studies and attempt to provide, to demonstrate their validity and consistency across time. So we'll once again be attempting to replicate the profiles for a third time, and then replicating the set of outcome variables from study four, so well-being and distress, engaged living, mindfulness, non-attachment, and empathy in another sample. So if they're found to be significant, we'll need to replicate that finding as well, not just the existence of the profiles, but the extent to which they independently predict variance. So this sample has actually been obtained for the specific purposes of this thesis. So in addition to including the variables that are present in study four, we've also added other theoretically relevant covariates, in particular basic psychological need satisfaction. So in this case, we'll be replicating the analytic strategy from the prior two studies. So the ESM combined with latent profile analysis, and then comparing the profiles once and then comparing them a second time whilst controlling for the global and specific factors to test their incremental validity. Same hypotheses and research questions as in study four as well. So I haven't gone into too much detail here because it really serves to replicate that which I've kind of more thoroughly articulated in the preceding studies, just to beautify them and make them a bit more certain. Not that I should say that in research. And in this, so we have a sample here of 6,063 Americans. So we used missing data by design in this sample. So I'll be using Amelia 2 to impute missing data in this sample. Using obviously the variables from study 4 as already articulated, and adding the basic psychological need satisfaction and frustration scale. So a couple of last important things to point out, given that I've touched on all of the studies now. The first is that there are no ethical considerations within my thesis because it all includes data that's already been collected and collected within studies that for which ethics was already granted. So no risks of that kind. I've estimated a budget of $5,000. So in summary, the aim of the thesis is to use a total sample of 11,818 people to first synthesize the literature and then create and test a person-centered analytical framework for the analysis of aspirations. I've been really lucky and am indeed really grateful to have had access to such an enormous sample of people, 11,818 people, to test these ideas in the theory. That certainly wouldn't be the case if I hadn't been given access to the data, nor would it be the case that I have my current level of knowledge or happy state of mind were it not for Varjinda and Rich, and of course Joseph, who isn't here today, who needs to be thanked, and Phil, and you know what, indeed lots of people in the room who have contributed to my ideas and research thus far. It's really heartening to work in such a collegial environment. So,
oh, wait for the question.
So I wanted to say thank you for that, and thank you for listening.
Fantastic presentation.
Oh, thanks.
I was wondering about do you have any expectations about a pattern of the seven variables that you might expect that would still be there even after all that variance was parceled out?
So the pattern should remain. The pattern should remain even after we obliterate the variance. What's going to be obliterated is the extent to which the profile predicts things. That's the extent to which the profiles differ on outcome variables. So in terms of the shapes that I expect, apart from expecting that there's a more relative emphasis on one type of aspirations versus another, it's really hard to predict. That said, I mean, there are some of the intrinsic versus extrinsic individual aspirations are more correlated and more reliably correlated than others. Physical health and image are obvious ones, so those who aspire to be perceived as attractive by others also tend to pursue a healthy lifestyle, so it's feasible that a profile would be high in both of those, if that's a common manifold. Otherwise, I don't really have any specific aspirations. Once we separate level, that's really not been done before, to kind of see what shape looks like. The aspiration index has never been looked at using the combination of the ESM and LPA.
Thank you.
Yeah, so if it doesn't, but if, just like, so I suppose I'm thinking about it sort of a risk management point of view, if it doesn't come out after all that, you've still got enough different with all your other stuff though.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it may still have utility in answering the question of what explains some of this unexplained heterogeneity. If we assess the existence of subgroups and when we control for the aspirations themselves, those subgroups no longer predict variance. It's probably the case that that answers that question, that it's not due to the existence of subsamples that we have considerable heterogeneity.
Super impressive. I think the one thing that most people won't understand, you were talking on two levels to that thing. I mean, you're talking both to mixture model skeptics and non-humans at the same time. You did a really nice job of balancing those.
I know there are some in the room.
The one thing I was thinking about is, again, coming back to what that latent variable is. So that, what that, and that's important for a couple of reasons. One is, there's implications for which of those theories that you had up front are true or otherwise, and also it has an implication for what the replication means. And so, for example, if that latent variable is biological, that means something different than if it's cultural, for example. And so I was wondering, you know, if that latent variable is cultural, and so people are born into some kind of subculture within society to which they assimilate their aspirations, then if it doesn't replicate across countries, then, well, maybe that's obvious. Maybe that's a case of that the cultures are completely different in Hungary to Australia, but if it's biological, it's something different. So I was wondering if you could talk to what you think that latent variable might be.
Well, I think that there's something to the self and other orientedness of aspirations that we haven't quite adequately tapped yet, that extrinsic aspiring is thought to reflect an emphasis on you and your goals and how they benefit you, but you're obviously dependent on external feedback in order to have that satisfied in the extrinsic domain, versus intrinsic aspirations, which are more reflective of an orientation toward other people. So I think that it's possible that we may find that the shape of profiles reflects that. More of it, like if that were to be the case, we might find, for example, so personal growth would be the one exception to that, in that intrinsic domain that is dependent on other people or revolves around kind of involving other people in your value system. Personal growth is really still about you and your growth. So we might expect to find that through the profiles, an increasing emphasis, a shape that helps to articulate that. So we might find, for example, that a high intrinsic profile with a focus on relationships and giving to the community, for example, might be low in personal growth if it reflects other orientation versus self-orientation. Felicia?
First, just to echo the others, it was such a pleasure to listen. I love the depth and the clarity.
Thank you.
So I just want to ask you a question about outcome measures. You said you have various measures of optimal functioning,
right.
You've talked about self-actualization, you've talked about well-being. Can you just sort of clarify how these measures relate to each other and how you've actually measured these things?
Which scales have been used to operationalize the variables? So well-being is Key's measure. So I guess I'll broadly touch on why I expect the types of profiles to relate to these particular indices. And it's obviously because I don't have much to go upon other than that which exists from a variable-centered basis. So I can really only make hypotheses that, even though we're in a person-centered framework, that depend upon what we already know from variable-centered analyses. So a focus on intrinsic aspirations is thought to promote psychological need satisfaction, and we all know that psychological need satisfaction promotes a variety of things. So not even just well-being. I could expand this. I don't have any control apart from, no, I don't need control anymore of any of it because it's all been collected, but we could have measured a variety of other things, but we've just chosen ones that would reflect that sense of self-actualization or life happiness, life contentment, given that they're thought to be a function of psychological need satisfaction, and an intrinsic orientation is also thought to reflect satisfaction of those needs. So we're doing keys. I'm using variables from the Australian Character Study, so once again, they're already there, and I didn't have an opportunity to dictate what they would be. but we're using well-being, psychological, social, and emotional well-being as measured by keys. The GHQ, General Health Questionnaire, to measure distress. The Engaged Living Scale to measure value congruent living and life fulfilling. Mindfulness using the MARS, and also in the American sample, I have access to FFMQ as well. And the 7-item attachment scale and the basic empathy scale, so cognitive and affective empathy, which if my other oriented hypotheses are possible, we should expect to find empathy increases in more intrinsically oriented profiles as well.
Thanks. Can I just follow up? Mm-hmm. With the GHQ, years ago I published something showing that if you analyse separately the negatively worded and the positively worded items, you can get a scale of distress versus well-being.
Oh, interesting.
And they relate quite differently to a lot of other measures. Right. So you can get that for free.
Yeah, great. Good recommendation. Thanks. Yes,
I don't mind just thinking about aspirations and you know, this idea that we have extrinsic, intrinsic, but then also potentially differences in level as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just, I suppose, wondering in the modelling, I'm not familiar with latent profile analysis, mm-hmm. unfortunately, at this point, are you controlled for kind of a common factor that could potentially capture that?
As in what is shared between the intrinsic and extrinsic?
Yeah, so
we're dividing those apart on the basis of the theoretical distinction of intrinsic and extrinsic.
Yeah.
It is entirely possible for us to create exactly the same model with one global factor for aspiring, leaving behind the same 7, but then we would be unable to differentiate intrinsic versus extrinsic level. So in all likelihood, a model with a single G factor won't fit the data as well as a model with 2 because they're so reliably distinct from one another. So those intrinsic and extrinsic effects will account for what you're thinking of right now.
Yeah, so you don't partial amount simultaneously. It's basically the bifactor kind of effectively is an alternative having a global factor.
So those level effects aren't controlled for in the development of the profiles. They're controlled for in the comparison of the profiles in the test of incremental validity. So once we take out all of the variants, so those global factors will definitely include what is common across related variables, but also probably less substantive information like response tendencies and things like that. So it is important for us to partial that out when comparing 3 profiles to test the extent to which that stuff matters in predicting optimal functioning.
Thank you so much, Emma. Now I have a bigger picture of what your project's about.
Oh, great.
So that's really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Because you didn't even get to mention the HSM data,
right.
Et cetera. But it's, so I wanted to ask you how you saw, in that other data set, we're looking at goal mm-hmm. aspirations in a way,
yeah.
and behavior change.
Mm-hmm.
Would you expect that goal satisfaction or goal achievement
mm.
would be related to well-being? So a person who has maybe a profile of aspiration that means that the person might not satisfy them
uh-huh.
will lead to less well-being. So if it's a behavior change for achieving health
mm-hmm.
and you set up goals that for reasons that you indicate that you're less likely to satisfy
oh,
them,
yeah.
maybe you will be less well.
Yeah, your likelihood of achievement is detrimental to the impact, regardless of the type of aspiration. If you aspire for something and you can't meet that aspiration, it's negative. The impact
yeah.
is negative, yeah.
So will you be able to use some of this in the analysis of the data set, for example?
The HSM data set?
That's what... I realize it's not about your thesis, but...
What's tricky about the HSM data set is that we have no metric of goal completion. So if they were, we have the goals they've signed up for, but not whether they finished them, nor whether they felt they could. So we would definitely be able to assess that if we had those 2 metrics, but we don't.
I have another data set where we're doing.
Oh yeah, okay. So yeah, I mean, obviously we could ascertain the first 2 of those, what they sign up for and if they complete it from their own reporting on the website, but the likelihood of completion, we probably need to devise something unique to tap that, which I think would actually be important.
In any of these data sets, do you have the attainment?
No, we only have importance, yeah.
Because I just want to point out that hypotheses from SAT are different for attainment than they are for valuing.
Right, right.
Because and there's been some pretty clear predictions on that too, but I guess that won't be relevant there because we won't know.
We don't have that yet, exactly.
My question was sort of a follow-up to that. Isn't there a systematic difference between intrinsic and extrinsic, and that intrinsic is much more controllable and therefore achievable?
Yeah, and that hypothesis carries through to findings in lower socioeconomic populations where satisfaction of intrinsic aspirations is not very likely. You don't have money to give to charity, you don't have time to help others, I guess your relationships could be close but are possibly strained by other exogenous factors, and intrinsic aspirations are found to be negative for well-being in those types of populations where you can't satisfy your intrinsic aspirations.
Yeah. Just thinking about the items and the aspiration, is it possible to clearly define how those things can be attained? So the items are something like giving to the community is important. It's really vague.
Right, it's subjective, yeah.
So attainment again would be subjective. So I could, smile at Emma and think, I'm done.
There's been various studies on attainment. I mean, I don't want to derail this particular discussion, but sometimes attainment's been asking people to what extent have you been able to accomplish that goal. And those attainment things have been done in the prediction course there, is that extrinsic attainments, even when you're successful at them, don't predict great increments in wellness, whereas intrinsic attainments do. And that pattern's been borne out in that number of studies have written.
Yeah. You've assessed it not even just cross-sectionally, but longitudinally too.
Longitudinally as well, so we've actually been able to look longitudinally at whether people have what their aspirations were. Turns out that aspirations tend to be accomplished. So people who want money tend to make more money than people who don't. People who want love tend to get more love in life than people who don't. But those differentially predict outcomes pretty
systematically.
So there's been a number of studies on that, but objectively, sometimes people, like Tim, has looked at some things about whether intrinsic aspirations translate into actually less consumerism, for instance, and so there's been some, but I wouldn't call it comprehensive work, so most of it's been built around subjective attainment and not objective attainment. Mm-hmm. It's hard to measure in both spheres in a way, except for money.
Oh yeah.
That's why I have money.
That's all?
One name is missing here. We need somebody who wears.
You need four people on the panel?
Yeah.
Yeah, so Phil's on the panel.
And your name is not there, that's why I was wondering. Thank you. All right. Well, all right. May I ask all the other people to be outside and this panel be staying here?
Just call me.